Good afternoon. I am Kaleem Shabazz, the president of the Atlantic City branch of the NAACP, welcoming you to our first program of 2021. Our first Tuesday, we want to wish everyone a happy, safe, and healthy 2021. And of course, our prayer and our hope is that 2021 is going to be better than 2020. And we wish that for all of our listeners in our audience, all of our old listeners, all of our new listeners. If you are an old listener, thank you for your support. If you are a new listener, thank you for being with us. And please tell your friends and your coworkers that NAACP is heard every Tuesday here on WEHA 88.7 and 100.3 FM every Tuesday from 4:30 to 5:30. And under our new format, we are very pleased to have, and you'll hear him in a couple of minutes, Dr. Wilson Washington Jr., who is a public health expert. He's director of the Health Department and Human Services for the City of Atlantic City. And he has been our regular guest for the last two programs, and he will continue to bring us updates on public health. And as we say every week, if you want accurate public health information about COVID-19, about the flu and other things to keep your health up, then you listen to Dr. Wilson Washington Jr. and not the health experts, the fake experts in the barbershop and the beauty parlor. And nothing against the barbershop and the beauty parlor. We love our barbershops and our beauty parlors and the people who go there, but they're not health experts. And even though they have a right to express their opinion, you shouldn't be guided by their opinion, especially in this day and time. Also, when we get to the announcements, all the announcements are important, but coming up is our MLK program, and our very capable co-host is going to make that in our announcements. This year, we're going to have a different form because of the virus, and she'll tell you about that. And we're going to have, in addition, we're going to have a radiothon, and she'll tell you about that. For some of the younger members, they don't even know what a radiothon is. Dr. Washington, I had to explain that to some of the younger branch members, what a radiothon is. And Yolanda will talk about that when we get to the announcements. I want to make my own announcement. I'm going to be practicing some dance moves because people who donate $100 or more, they'll see me do some dance moves at this radiothon. So I'm getting ready. Let me also say good evening to our studio audience. We thank them for their support in 2020 and going forward in 2021, we look forward to having them. As we do every week, we salute the leader of WHA, President William Hawks, Elder Hawks, and our outstanding engineering staff, Brother Stefan and Brother Taryn, and Taryn. We thank them for their support in 2020 and looking forward to them in 2021, and also looking forward to them on MLK Day when they will be working with us again. And it's again our sad duty to start off 2021 giving a tribute to all of those New Jersey citizens, now almost 19,000 who have passed away to COVID-19. All those people who unfortunately are in the hospital, all those people who have coming down with COVID-19, our prayer is for the strength of their families, their relatives. Each and every life is a precious life, and we are in support and lift up all of those lives that have been lost to this disease. And we encourage you to, as we said, listen to our public health experts, and hopefully we will be able to put this disease in the rearview mirror. Having said that, for the first time in 2021, our distinguished, esteemed, honorable now partner in her law firm, Yolanda Melville Esquire, our co-host. Yolanda, good afternoon for 2021.
Good afternoon, President. Good afternoon to our studio audience. Good afternoon, Dr. Washington. I'm so pleased to be with you for another year of our great program. I know we're heard around the state of New Jersey and on our social media networks. We have wide-reaching capabilities and we are heard in many states, as we often hear that the work that we're doing here in Atlantic City, little old Atlantic City, has not gone unnoticed. So I want to give a special shout out to our listeners on the radio, our studio audience, as well as our social media listeners as well. So first we're going to start off with the announcements. And I look forward to our panelists or guests at the 5 o'clock hour who are going to be Assemblyman Vince Mazzio and John R. Motto. I'm having some difficulties here trying to find my announcements. I apologize. Just a little technical difficulties.
Okay.
Before I start my announcements, actually, let's turn over to Dr. Washington, and I promise I'll be ready as soon as the Zoom allows me to. Dr. Washington, do you have your update for this week?
I think you're on mute, Doc.
Okay, good afternoon, Atlantic City. As the mayor, Marty Small, would say, it's a great day in the city of Atlantic City. It's always a great day in the city of Atlantic City. I'll be quick today because we certainly have a nice lineup on the panel today, but I do want to reemphasize some things.
He's muted.
Can't hear you, Dr. Washington.
Can't hear you. Can't hear you.
I think Zoom is giving us all a bit of difficulty for today. Looks like he's
back. We missed you, Dr. Washington. Could you start again?
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the City of Atlantic City. And I'm hoping that you can hear me. We're having a little bit of signal problem, but I want to say Happy New Year to everyone and say that we made it. We made it to 2021 and we made it by working together and by listening and by taking each other's advice and keeping each other's best interest.
Dr. Washington, I think you're having some more issues.
There you go.
We can't hear you.
I tell you what, Yolanda May, you better go back to your announcements, then we'll go back to Dr. Washington.
Yeah, absolutely. So we'll try that. Dr. Washington, we'll take a brief pause in your announcements this week, and I'll go into my announcements.
Okay, let me pull out and come back.
Okay, perfect. We'll at our 5 o'clock half hour, we'll have again Assemblyman Vince Mazzio as well as John Armato to talk about legislative priorities for 2021, as well as their initiatives, as well as their involvement with the NAACP. We also want to announce, as President Shabazz alluded to, our annual Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. program, which will be held Monday, January 18th, 2021. So in less than 2 weeks, we will have our annual Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. program. And this year will be a little bit different. We will actually have an entirely virtual platform. And what that means is we have a host of sponsors who have all agreed to join us this year as we present to you on a virtual platform, and we'll be simulcast opportunities on their respective platforms, as well as the Atlantic City NAACP networks, social media networks. We will also be broadcast here live on WEHA Gospel 88.7 and 100.3, who continues to be a steadfast partner in the community programming that we do here with the NAACP. Along with WEHA, we will be also having the following sponsors. We will have the City of Atlantic City, who's been a longstanding sponsor with us in our actual live program, Second Baptist Church of Atlantic City, St. James AME Church of Atlantic City, and Congregation Beth Israel from Northfield. So again, we will have a simulcast through all of their social media networks, as well as opportunities through Zoom to watch the event. At what time is the event on Dr. Martin Luther King Day? It's going to start at noon, 12 noon, until 1:30 p.m. on all virtual platforms. What that also means, unfortunately, that we are not able to join and coalesce in person. So we will unfortunately not have the march again this year. We will be moving it to an entirely virtual platform. But as always, there's opportunities for you to join us in many ways through our programming. So not all is lost, even though we cannot see each other in person. We promise this will be an abundance of information and a good time as we celebrate the life of Dr. Martin Luther King. Our featured speaker for this event is our esteemed president of the Greater Red Bank NAACP and minister. He's a youth and young adult pastor at Second Baptist Church of Asbury Park. And he's been with us on our program here at NAACP Speaks. His name is Minister Kerwin Webb. He is also a member of the 2018 graduating class of the NAACP's Next Gen program. So we are honored to have Mr. Minister Kerwin Webb to be our keynote speaker for this year's event. So again, it will be an entirely virtual platform, Monday, January 18th, 2021, 12 noon to 1:30 p.m. So please follow us on social media as we continue to provide more information. And again, thank you to our sponsors, the Atlantic City NAACP, of course, City of Atlantic City, WEHA Gospel, Second Baptist Church in Atlantic City, St. James Church in Atlantic City, and Congregation Beth Israel of Northfield. We also want to announce a few different programs that will be happening before the MLK program on Monday and shortly thereafter. And one of them will be our first ever, and hopefully not the last one, our weekend dance party fundraiser. Now, how is this different? We've never hosted a dance party, even though the NAACP has over the last year or so been able to provide a lot of opportunities to get out the vote and do virtual parties. But this event this weekend will be a continuation of our programming on Monday to start that off. And we will have KJ Butter as our DJ. He is a Atlantic City resident. He is a member of the NAACP here in Atlantic City and is just a phenomenal community servant and activist here in our community. And he will be our DJ for the event. So that event will be hosted on Sunday, January 17th from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. And we are asking people to join us by donating $25 to kick off our fundraising opportunities for 2021. Spots are extremely limited. So if you need more information about this particular dance party, please visit the Atlantic City social media networks on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. And as our prolific president has mentioned, he will be putting on his dancing shoes to join us for this fundraiser, hopefully. We also want to announce that following our 2021 annual Dr. Martin Luther King program, that we will be having our first ever radiothon from 2 p.m. to 5 p.m. right here on WEHA. And we will also simulcast that in our Atlantic City NAACP social media networks. And we are hopefully going to meet our goal for this year to raise as much money as we can to support the programs here with the Atlantic City NAACP. And as all roads lead to 2022, as we host our annual convention for the NAACP here in Atlantic City. So that event will be following our 2021 Dr. Martin Luther King Day program, which ends at 1:30, and we will move quickly into a 2 p.m., 3-hour, 2 to 5 radiothon right here on WEHA Gospel, 88.7 and 100.3. President, do you have anything to add on that?
Just a quick aside to some of our younger members, millennials and Generation Xers who don't know what a radiothon is. Dr. Washington and myself in the studio audience know what a radiothon is. A radiothon is a tool of the 60s that we use for civil rights and Vietnam protests, where we have a prolonged time on the radio. We have people come in and give speeches. We have people to do readings, and we collect and raise money. And we use the radiothon. Of course, now with the social media that you so graciously and articulately and efficiently represent Yolanda. We're going to have it on other medias and other platforms. But the radiothon is a intense period of time where we are trying to raise funds. And the reason we're doing this is because of the virus, we can't do our normal fundraising. And we would hope everyone will participate. And for those of you who doubt my dancing ability, I'm getting ready. And I will be ready to show out and show up and show off for the NAACP.
I'm not sure, President, if everyone heard what you said. I think the connection was intermittent again. So can you give us a wrap up of what you said really quickly?
Oh, okay. I thought, okay. We're having difficulty. I apologize to the audience. What I said was, for those in the younger generation who don't know what a radiothon is an event that focuses on a specific topic or concern. We did it during the 60s for civil rights, and we did it on the Vietnam anti-protest. What this is going to be a 3-hour period, and we're going to have testimonials, we're going to have entertainment, and we're going to collect and raise funds for the NAACP. And I say, Yolanda, that I'm getting ready to do my dancing for people who give more than $100 to the NAACP effort. And the reason we're doing this is because of the virus, we couldn't have the fundraisers that we normally have. And as you said, we have many programs that need funding, and we are having a fundraiser, the radiothon, and also the dance party, as you talked about, and we hope everyone will support that.
Thank you so much. So for my generation, we will consider this a throwback party. So hopefully we can have plenty of our 40 and under crowd who will come to our event that Sunday, which will be a fundraiser kickoff party, as well as our day program on MLK Day, as well as the radiothon, as we just talked about. So thank you for that. And that, stay tuned on our social media networks for more information. I also want to make sure that everyone is aware, and I'm sure Dr. Washington will be talking about this very shortly, that there are now opportunities to pre-register for the vaccine through our New Jersey .gov portals. So if you visit /covidvaccine.nj.gov, there are opportunities for each one of us as New Jersey residents to reserve a spot by pre-registering for the vaccine. And there is a pre-registration form that you have to complete. You have to give information such as your personal contact information, health insurance, and demographic, and you'll be able, if eligible, to schedule an appointment to be administered the vaccine as soon as your spot is available. So I don't want to take Dr. Washington's thunder, but I certainly want to highlight that for anybody who wanted more information. Also, we have an opportunity again, as I've spoken every week, to have our young people have a voice in the future of anti-bias education and standing up to hate in New Jersey. And what do I mean by that? The New Jersey Division of Civil Rights has created a student competition where our young people ages 25 and younger can submit into 3 categories: a slogan or hashtag, artwork design, or a 10 to 60 second video on their particular original artwork on why standing up to hate is very important here in New Jersey. So I know we have a lot of ground to cover, and it's already 4:49. And I want to just, again, anyone that you know who is 25 years or younger and is a New Jersey State resident who believes in the commitment to civil rights and standing up to hate in our communities, please have them exercise their opportunity to send in original artwork to the New Jersey Division of Civil Rights for our competition as we move forward in addressing bias, stereotype, and prejudice in our communities. I just want to, again, point everyone to our social media networks. If you'd like to be a member of the NAACP, you can do that by visiting naacp.org/become a member. And our branch is 2077B for the Atlantic City branch. And again, a membership is $30 for 1 year, or you can send your information, including your name, address, email address, and phone number to the Atlantic City NAACP, P.O. Box 1182, Absecon, New Jersey, 08201. And President, I think that's it for my announcements this week.
Thank you so much, Yolanda. And we really appreciate you, as always. Looking forward to a banner year. I think we have 10 minutes left. So we're going to start with Dr. Washington, then we'll go with our voices of the youth, Alexander Brand.
Okay.
Dr. Washington.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm hoping that you can hear me. I'll make it short this year. Our focus is on doing a better job in 2021 to make sure we get the word out. Certainly we're inside the flu season. We're inside the vaccinations are here. The state of New Jersey is using a Moderna vaccine. There are different stages that the vaccine will be deployed in our community. At two phases, but phase one has three phases. 1A includes the healthcare workers and long-term care congregate settings. And 1B includes your frontline essential staff workers and individuals over 75 years old. And 1C, phase 1C include the other essential workers and the adults 65 to 74. And also those that are actually 16 to 50 to 64 that may have medical conditions. So we're focusing this year on getting the vaccine out. Phase two is for your general population. That'll probably be a little later on in the year. But what I want to say is, trust the vaccines are safe. We're way behind in terms of numbers of vaccines. And as Yolanda mentioned earlier, there is a website that you can go on. She provided it, which was the COVID HTTPS :// covidvaccine.newjersey.gov. But we also have another site in Atlantic County, and it's the AC, www.aclink.org. On both of those sites, you can find out where the vaccines are being given, and you can also pre-register if you fit in those categories to be targeted for either a phase one or a phase one Alpha, one Bravo, one Charlie, which is where we're focusing on now.
Dr. Washington, could you give us the Atlantic County link again, please?
Changed this year. Certainly, COVID has changed everything. It's been, it's driven the COVID vaccine, the COVID pandemic has driven monumental changes, massive changes, how we live, how we eat, our socioeconomic status has changed significantly. So in 2021, my recommendation is that we focus on shifting our habits and our behaviors to a more healthy lifestyle, because health makes a real difference in our ability to survive the storm, both our physical health and our mental health. And so we need to be working on paying attention to those things that you're eating, reading the labels. I know a lot of food manufacturing companies are putting all the nutritional products in their foods on the back of the label. So read the labels, make sure that you are eating foods that are good for your mind, body, and spirit, your soul, because you also want to engage in physical activity, because the more physical activity, more physical fit you are, the better you're going to be able to negotiate this COVID-19 storm. We also want to take some supplements that may boost our immune system that will support overall health and well-being. Some of the things are antioxidants, minerals like zinc, healthy fats like omega fats, and also vitamins like vitamin D, vitamin C, and turmeric. We certainly want to focus on those kind of things, because they'll help to improve your immunity system. We also want to focus on healthy sleeping habits. Get enough sleep, because your sleep helps with improving your mental health. So we're focusing this year on physical health, mental health, and nutrition. So with that, I want to say everybody eat healthy, work out, practice safe distancing. If you go out and do a walk, make sure you're wearing your mask, making sure when you come back in the house, wash your hands, use every means of sanitizing that you can. If you go into the grocery stores, take advantage, or even the shopping stores, take advantage of the hand sanitizer stations to wash your hands. Hand washing has proven to stop the spread of this disease called COVID-19. And we also want to watch your family, watch yourself, look for signs, difficulty breathing, sneezing, dizziness, headaches, a loss of smell or taste. If you have any of those signs, contact your doctor, your primary care provider, let them know what's going on. Check your temperatures, making sure your temperatures stay below 100.4. So again, all these are recommendations on how we can keep ourselves healthy in this environment, and get ready to line up to take the vaccines if it's offered, and do pre-register because it'll save a lot of time. Atlantic County has designated our Atlantic City Convention Center as a mega center for doing the vaccine. There are also other places, there are contracts that will be with Walgreens and CVS, and also ShopRite pharmacies, but that's more information to come. In the meantime, let's stay safe, let's stay healthy, let's eat healthy. Thank you.
Thank you. See you next week, Dr. Watson. Thank you. Thank Alexander.
You. Yes, sir. How you doing?
Good, good, sir.
So yeah, I came to talk about the Georgia runoff election and why it is important. So, you know, just to start it off, you know, a Georgia state rule is a winning candidate needs to earn 50% of the votes. This past election, you know, both candidates failed to do that. So the top two candidates in a November election go through a January runoff. Well, a January replay, which is called runoff election. And this matters. This is so important because it's not just about Georgia. It's about the country. About the country, and it's about what we represent, you know. It's very important to get these certain laws passed, you know, get it involves cabinet appointments. It involves the Supreme Court justices and who goes on a bench. It involves even taxes. If we are a nonpartisan organization, but if Democrats win in Georgia, that gives two extra seats to the Democrat. It gives two extra seats to the Democrat in the Senate, which gives us control. Not us, I'm sorry, which gives the Democrats control, because if it's a tie, it goes up to our wonderful Vice President, Kamala Harris.
Right.
How much more time do I have?
You got 1 minute.
Okay, well, you can Google who the candidates are. You know, John Ossoff, he's running up against 70-year-old David Perdue, and you got Reverend Raphael Warnock, who's running against Senator Kelly Loeffler. I do want to say these quick stats. 100,000 to 15 people are showing up that didn't show up in the November 3rd election. Out of that 100,000, 40% make up people of color. That's a 60% surge from last year's election. The only way we show up, the only way we change things is if we show up. So these numbers are very exciting, not just to Georgia, but to the country, to New Jersey. And, you know, I say this and then I'm gone. You know, President Shabazz, y'all have a runoff election coming up as well. But I guess we can talk about that later.
We'll talk about that. Thank you so much, Alexander Bland, one of our youth leaders and voices. And as 2021 goes on, you will be hearing more about him. We're almost at our 5 o'clock hour. Yolanda and RC, our two guests have come on. We are very pleased and happy to have our two legislative representatives from the 2nd District, Assemblyman John Armato and Assemblyman Vince Mazzio, who are Democratic representatives of the 2nd Ward in the Assembly. And although the NAACP is a nonpartisan organization, I'm proud and happy to say that both of them are members of the Atlantic City branch of the NAACP, and Assemblyman Armato happens to be a member of the task force on infant and maternal mortality. And just for the record, they joined before they ran. They didn't join just because of their campaign. as some people do, and I'm not saying any names, but I say we appreciate their commitment to civil rights and social justice year round, because civil rights and social justice is a nonpartisan continuing fight, and we thank them for their support of that. Yolanda, do you want to introduce them? Now, just we're starting off, this is the first show. And just for those people who listen, they know that Yolanda and I have had an ongoing friendly competition about whose guest is who. But as some of the guests have agreed, I have gotten the unequal proposition here because Yolanda has superior skills as a lawyer. So I'm a lay person, and my count is in question. So now, for the record, the first show of 2021, Yolanda, these guests will say they are the show's guests. Is that correct, or are they your guests?
Absolutely. As a person who did receive top billing this weekend in the press of Atlantic City for his comments on behalf of the Atlantic City NAACP and the Attorney General's use of force policies, certainly we can share the guests this week. Because okay. I do not want to overstep a celebrity this week.
No, since we're talking about the press, before we introduce our guest, just for the record, you were also in there as the partner for Cooper Levinson. Again, we congratulate you for making partner. They had a very nice picture and article on the new partners, Next Generation. We salute you. Okay.
Thank you.
All
but right. I think I was on page 4. You were on page 1. These are all friendly jokes, Assemblyman. We're just joking here. So welcome to you both, Assemblyman Armato and Assemblyman Mazzio. First, what we do is we read your bios, and the first question we always ask is for you to just tell our listening audience three additional things about you. So we'll start with you, as I see you first, Assemblyman Armato. John Armato is the Assemblyman for the New Jersey's 2nd Legislative District, along with Assemblyman Vince Mazzio. The 2nd Legislative District represents most of Atlantic County, from the farmlands on the western end of the county all the way to the shore. Elected to the Buena Vista Township Committee in 2015, John Armato served as an environmental and green energy advocate, while also fighting to keep Buena Vista affordable for middle-class families. Did I say that correctly? I know there's a Buena Vista is the correct way to say it.
Yes, it is.
All right, great.
It depends if you're from New Jersey or California.
That's right.
California is buena.
Right, exactly. So as an assemblyman, he has taken the lead against the opioid and heroin epidemic. He's been on the forefront of working to educate New Jersey families on safe prescription drug practices and disposal. Likewise, Assemblyman Armato has been a tireless advocate for veterans and union families. He served in the Armed Air Force from 1967 until 1971 during the Vietnam era. Once back, he worked as an HVAC specialist and was a member of the local 322. Assemblyman Armato has also been a volunteer firefighter with the Richland Fire Squad since 1971. He is a member of the Agriculture, Health, and Senior Services, and also a member of the Military and Veterans Affairs Committee. A graduate of Vineland High School, John Armato and his wife, Marie, have been married for 44 years. They have 2 beautiful children, Derek and Lauren, and 2 grandchildren. Welcome, Assemblyman Armato.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting us to be on your show today. 3 things that you didn't mention is hard because you mentioned just about everything there is. I am proud to be on the Atlantic County Drug Task Force and also a member of Join Together Atlantic County. Both which deal with the disease of addiction. Also, as you pointed out, I'm very proud to be with the Infant Mortality Task Force and with guidance from Councilman Shabazz, we are making headway. And I am here to tell you that we will be making policy not only for Atlantic City, Atlantic County, but for the state of New Jersey. We have tireless individuals who work tirelessly, and we're going to be having new and exciting things rolled out this year, and I just can't wait to get started. And for everyone listening, Happy New Year. I go out on a limb to say that 21 has to be better than 20, but we can only hope. But Thank you again for having us.
Welcome. Assemblyman Mazzio, we'll read your bio next, and then you can tell us three things about you. Assemblyman Vince Mazzio is the Assemblyman for the New Jersey 2nd Legislative District, comprising most of Atlantic County. Elected to the Northfield City Council in 2003 and subsequently as mayor in 2007, Vince has been an advocate for smaller, smarter government. As an Assemblyman, he's been on the forefront of working to reduce the property tax burden for Atlantic County's middle-class families and seniors by shared services, consolidation, and the stabilizing of Atlantic City, an effort that will spur new investment and jobs to our region. Likewise, Assemblyman Mazzio has been an advocate for seniors, veterans, and our local agricultural industries. He is the chair of the State and Local Government Committee, a member of Labor, and also a member of the Tourism, Gaming, and Arts Committee. As a small business leader, Assemblyman Mazzio has been a part of his family's fruit and produce business, BF Mazzio, for nearly 30 years. He is a graduate of Glassboro State College, which is now Rowan University, and he and his wife, Jerry, have been married for 24 years. They have two beautiful children, Amanda and Ted. Welcome, Assemblyman Mazzio.
I think he's muted.
Yes, he's muted. Assemblyman Mazzio, are you with us?
I'm here now, I'm sorry. Okay. I always forget to bat the mute. Thank you for putting, having us on your show today. It certainly is an honor. And we've been very, myself and Assemblyman Armato have been very close in working with Colleen Shabazz. And I think that we're not only talking about policy, but you know, it's good to have a friend in Atlantic City these days, and we certainly appreciate being on the show. Three things, I guess, that maybe certain people don't know about myself. How I got involved with politics, really, in 2003. Prior to that, I was a member of the Pleasantville Kiwanis Club for 17 years, a civic organization, which, you know, enrollment has really took a downturn. Pleasantville Kiwanis is no longer around because they didn't have any more membership, and they had to consolidate with Egg Harbor Township. Another area that I guess it's just something I used to do for fun before I got in politics. I used to be an avid golfer, but I haven't played in a while, but it's been a few years. But I'm trying to get back into it. My wife said I have to make time for myself once in a while. Another thing that I'm very proud of that we just formed together as in the caucus is a business caucus and a Democratic caucus. So it's kind of a subcommittee of the Democratic caucus. And it's really an important thing to have the business caucus, because a lot of things, the businesses, you know, they get hit over the head, and particularly in the last couple of years with the minimum wage increase, the Family Leave Act, sick leave. So it's always a cost, but now during this COVID pandemic, a lot of businesses have been hit hard. So it's come to the forefront that we have to help businesses, because they do have, you know, they hire probably about 800 and some thousand people in the Atlantic County alone. So it's an important thing that I'm part of, and I think I bring a good perspective to that. So again, thank you for having me, and I look forward to the show.
Thank you both. President?
The first question for 2021, I'll yield to you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, President. And again, I want to actually congratulate you on your spread in the press of Atlantic City. It was all jokes, but I really want to say that you did us proud by what you said about use of force policy and what the Attorney General is doing.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you.
So the next question I think is a little unfair for you both, because I know your jobs are anything but typical. So can you give our listening audience a brief synopsis of a typical day in the life of a New Jersey Assemblyman?
You gonna start with?
Let's go with Assemblyman Mazzio. Mm-hmm.
Well, a typical, I don't know if everybody knows this, but we handle a lot of constituent services. Our office is made up of, we have a chief of staff, we have legislative aides, we have constituent services. Our depending on the time of the year or the maybe the policies that are going through Trenton, we could get anywhere from, I don't know, 100 calls or 10 calls a day to 100 calls a day. We have emails. We're always responding to constituent services. A big thing that's happening during the pandemic is we've been handling a lot of unemployment issues. It's been inundated since the get-go, as far as since March, about unemployment issues. And prior to COVID-19, we would have many different local places that we would have to go to. The NAACP, we go to different events throughout the city, throughout Atlantic County. We give out different citations, different awards, and we try to be someone who is an advocate for District 2 and what's going on in District 2. And that's what we try to bring to Trenton, to making sure that our voices are heard, particularly what's going on in Atlantic City, where we're diversifying the economy, trying to get it back where it was. We're doing a good job of that. And of course, the other part of it is we have bills that make policy in our area. And, you know, I'm on state and local government, so I deal with a lot of different bills that have to do with state and local government. One of the things that I'm on the forefront is shared services. We've been trying to do some things. It's been like 5 or 6 years with tax assessment, and trying to make it more affordable for people to stay in New Jersey, but in my district, trying to make sure it's more affordable in Atlantic County. That's kind of a brief synopsis. I'm sure Assemblyman Armato could add what to his day on. You know, he's retired, so I always have to say that John's retired, so he has a lot of more time than me, and he's been a great person to have in my corner, because if I can't make a meeting or something else, he is happy to jump in there for me.
You know, I think Vince always adds that just the less that he has the job and I don't. I think that's what he's trying to say. The big advantage to that, obviously, is that I'm able to attend more events. And I think Councilman Shabazz sort of hit it on the head that, Assembly Madrigal and myself, we like to be out there, not only in the year that we're running, but in the year that we're not running. I think that is extremely important. But a typical day, like Vince said, is just dealing with the constituents and what they expect from us to do. I always like to say this, and I truly mean this, that we work for you. You hired us to do a job, and that's what we're supposed to be doing. But the advantage is that I've been very involved in the food banks, and which are good and bad. You know, they're good because the amount of donations and food supplies that we give out is tremendous. The bad part of that ad is that so many people need it. I'm involved with Hope One, with Angels in Motion, and we do a lot of meals for homeless people, and try to interact with them people and try to figure out what their needs are. There's a lot of distrust out there. There's a lot of people who are homeless that refuse to go into shelters because they just don't trust them. We have to bridge that gap. Atlantic County is blessed with so many different agencies for help that go unused. And I think we have to, as legislators, to educate the public on what's available out there. Dealing with Join Together Atlantic County, our outreach for the disease of addiction is great. Unfortunately, with the pandemic, that sort of been pushed to the back. It's still there. It's still rampant, and we have to address it. But Zoom meetings are the key to everything right now. We don't go to Trenton. We everything is Zoom. We vote Zoom. We vote by telephone. It's I miss that. I'm on the health committee. I'm on the veterans committee. I'm on the agricultural committee. I miss interacting with the public. It's a lot easier for us to understand what their needs are when they can stand up before us and ask questions and give their input. So a typical day, we're busy. We're busy now. We were busy before. We just try to get the job done.
Before I turn it over to you, President, I do want to just encourage our listening audience to make sure that you follow both Assemblyman Armato and Assemblyman Mazzio on their social media because they are both absolutely correct. Not only during the election year are they active in their communities, but they certainly are very active in the community when they're in off years and when they're not running for their respective offices. And that is a testament to their social media presence. And we want to thank them and anyone who has an opportunity to follow them on social media and find out what's happening in their communities and join their efforts, please do. So, President, I'll turn it over to you for the next question.
Thank you very much. This is a combination question. We're going to start off with Assemblyman Armato and then go to Assemblyman Mazzio. First part of it, Senator Gill, who we all know, has introduced Senate Bill 99. This bill would allow New Jersey to have early voting. Let me tell you, first of all, the NAACP is adamantly for this bill. We believe that the more chances people have to vote, the better. I'd like to get your viewpoint on that, Assemblyman Armato and Mazzio. The second part about of that question is, can both of you tell us what are your respective 2021 legislative priorities? And we're running short on time, and I want to make sure we get all this in. We have 14 minutes to go, and I wanted to make sure you get in. So first of all, S-99, then legislative priorities, Assemblyman Armato.
I think it's come to time now that this is a necessity. I think COVID is going to bring us up into the 21st century where we have the ability to do this. When you think about voting on one single day, it presents multiples of problems. So voting early is a good thing. I think voting by mail is an excellent thing. Especially for the individuals who want to get it in the mail, get it out there. And the problem that we ran into, obviously, is the problem that the losers think that everything is corrupt. And obviously, it's not. So we have to keep moving forward with that. But I truly believe in early voting is a good thing, and voting by mail is a good thing. You want both questions?
Yeah, both questions. Yeah, then both.
Okay. Obviously, for me, as everyone knows, I'm very involved with the disease of addiction. I have goals set this year that we need to bring that back to the front page. It's been pushed back. We need to bring that back into the light and to be able to address it. And mental illness and the disease of addiction go hand in hand. Self-medication is a real problem, and that has to be addressed. And the ability to get help has to be out there. And once again, in Atlantic County and the state of New Jersey, there is a lot of agencies out there that can help. So that is one of my big priorities. Volunteerism is another one that has to be recognized for what it is. If you look at a volunteer fire department, if you would look at the cost that it would be to have a paid fire department, it's unsustainable. These things have to be recognized. And we have several bills out there that does that. One of the bills, which doesn't seem like a big thing, it's non-monetary, but I want 9/11 operators to be called first responders because that's what they are. They're the first person that you interact with. They need to be recognized. So these are some of the goals. Obviously, our unemployment has to be tightened up a little bit to get a little bit quicker response. These are some of the things that we're looking forward to, and these are some of the things that I look forward to working with.
Assemblyman Mazzio.
Yeah, anytime you can get more people involved in the voting and the democracy process, early voting, I think it's important that I would be in favor of that. And I think it's very important that any way we could get more people to vote is a good thing. The mail-in voting, there are some states, that's all they do. I think there's 5 states in the country that do all mail-in voting. And, I'm living proof of mail-in voting. My first time running in 2013 as a state assemblyman, election night, I was down 225 votes. And the mail-in votes took me over the top, and I won by 31 votes. So there's no corruption here. Just a small over I think 2 decades, over all the hundreds of millions of votes that were cast, I think there was 150 during the mail-in voting process, 100 150 fraud convictions out of 200 and some million votes. So it certainly is a good way. It's a safe way. And it's actually a paper trail. Before we had machines, we did have paper. And so mail-in voting is very, very good. And I think that, you know, any way we get more people involved in the process and getting them to vote, it's our democracy. And I think that we continue down this path, and I think it will. My priorities, I set out a goal for this term exactly because I am a small businessman. I certainly want to try and help the small businesses as much as I can. We have legislation in there for tax incentives to help small business. And it's very imperative right now that we really help the small businesses because they were hit so hard. As you look around, the restaurant business in our tourism district, it's been hit very hard. We must, you know, continue to work hard in trying to help these small businesses. The tax incentive that was just passed, the Economic Development Act of 2020, is a very good thing. I think it's going to give tax incentives to historical districts. The location improvement of, this is something for Atlantic City, of certain grocery stores and food deserts communities will get tax incentives as well. Main Street recovery, there's going to be money set aside for that. So these are things that we're going to keep working on. And of course, COVID is going to be continued through 2021. So we're going to have to be on the forefront of that as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Yolanda, another question?
Yes. Thank you both. So as we're wrapping up, we have about 8 more minutes left. And one, I don't want to overstep you, but in your capacity as councilman of Atlantic City, you had a community Zoom meeting last year. And certainly if you want to talk about it, but I want to talk with both assemblymen of legislation that's come out of those opportunities to coalesce, as Assemblyman Armato talked about. Even though you can't meet in person, there are opportunities to meet with the community virtually. And one of them was a community Zoom held by you. So Councilman, I'll turn it over to you, and then you can turn to the Assemblyman.
Okay, I was only going to say, I wanted to thank both of them for coming to that community Zoom, and did a quick commercial for people of the Third Ward or anyone who's interested. We're going to have another community Zoom on the 14th of this month at 6:00, and we cordially invite everybody to come. I just want to say several of my constituents, I was a little jealous to tell you the truth. They said, you got both assemblymen at your Zoom? I said, well, I'm your councilman. What about me? But seriously, I appreciate both of you coming on there. And either one of you can answer the question about the legislation coming out of the Zoom.
Whoever wants to make it. John, you want me to step in there? Or?
Sure. Drop off.
You know, one of the things, that meeting was very, very informative, and I appreciate you for having that, Councilman. Our understanding was about these crime areas in Atlantic City, particularly in apartment complexes where you have the laundry rooms, you have the staircases, or you have parking lots where perhaps there's not cameras there. There might be lighting there. There might be enough lighting, why don't we make it mandatory where apartment complexes, where you have cameras, so it not only protects the owners of the apartments, but it also protects the people who live in these apartments who are going upstairs or going to do their laundry. You know, the cameras for the police officers, that's a mandatory thing where there's actually funding that we just passed of $58 million to put cameras, making sure all police officers in every department in New Jersey has them. So we need to extend that for protection. You know, Atlantic City it's not a safe community, you know, from the outside. But as you talk to the police officers and they're talking to the community, and we're having this relationship between the community and the police officers. So these are ideas that came about. And so we're going to try to put legislation that mandates, and don't get me wrong, we're not trying to put cost for these apartment complexes, but on the other end, you think about it, if someone gets hurt in the staircase, there's probably frivolous lawsuits. So it's really protecting the apartment owners and the people who live there and anybody else that you have a camera on it. And so, you know, we could catch, there are some bad people out there. So we want to make sure it's a safe area.
You know, also, Kaleem, I think that You know, in your world and in our world, everything is visual. It doesn't matter if it's right. It doesn't matter if it's wrong. What does it look like? And right now, Atlantic City looks unsafe. And I got to commend the police department for doing one heck of a job, because they're getting better, and the city is getting better. We just have to project that. We have to make sure that, you know, we obviously we're a tourist destination, and if people don't feel safe, they're not going to come. So I think that's a high priority for us, is to change the image of our shore, you know, be it Ventnor, Margate, Longport, Atlantic City, wherever it may be. We have to change that perception. And once we do that, I think good things will come. And I think with the community itself, I think the community has to be brought on board. And I think they are. They have to step up and say, I saw this happen, you know, and they have the ability to do that. And once that happens, I think we're destined for just good things.
Thank you very much, both of you, Assemblyman. And again, I want to invite both of you to come to the public Zoom that I'm going to have on January 14th and announce that. I think it's important also, of course, people listening here, but people who follow that Zoom, it's important for them to know that there's follow-up for the meetings. And I appreciate both of you for introducing that. Also, I want to shout out my councilman colleague, Councilman Randolph, who's on from the First Ward. He's going to be on that Zoom too. And let me assure both of you that we are very focused on public safety in Atlantic City as local elected officials. And we are going to continue working with the police. And I'm gonna ask the chief to make a report about what you said about Assemblyman Amato. There are many, many calls that the police department get from citizens. And I asked the chief to give you the actual statistics. I know from my life as a council person and working with the police that many people call in. More should, but there's a great number. And you're right, I think the biggest thing is the perception. A friend of mine since passed away, Bernie Poppick, who was a public relations genius, he used to always say, he said, Kaleem, perception is reality. So if people perceive something is true, it's true. And there are much improvement we can make in public safety, but we're going to continue to do that. It's also, public safety is a civil rights and a social justice issue also, because areas that have more resources have a higher degree of public safety. And what we're trying to do is increase that. Assemblyman, it's 5:28. I'm gonna start with you, Assemblyman Massey, if you 30 seconds to wrap up, then Assemblyman Armando, 30 seconds to wrap up, and then Yolanda, 30 seconds to wrap up, then we'll be out. 30 seconds to wrap up.
All right, thank you again, Councilman and Yolanda. I appreciate us coming on here and telling a little bit what we're doing. And certainly I want to wish your listeners there a happy and healthy new year. And you know, 2020, it's behind us now. Let's move forward into 2021 and let's all work together. Wouldn't that be fun? Wouldn't that be something that we could all do, work together and really hit some goals and get something done, not only for, you know, Atlantic City, but also Atlantic County, and make it a great place for everyone to live and come and have fun at. Thank you.
Thank you, Assembly.
Yeah, I'd like to just thank you all for having us. I enjoy the opportunity greatly to interact. I just want to again emphasize that our office has a lot of contacts and the ability to help, be it unemployment, be it with the disease of addiction, be it with housing, whatever the problems are. You know, I can't tell you that for sure we can help every single person, but I can tell you for sure that we will help as many people as we can, and we will try to help every single person. So once again, thank you for having us. Happy, safe new year, and look forward to another meeting with you guys, but thank you.
Yolanda, 30 seconds.
I want to thank both of you, Assemblyman Armando, for coming, Assemblyman Mazzio, and I just want to also just make a pitch to our young people. We have four different elected officials with us today on this afternoon's program, and I just want to ensure that you all have an opportunity to get to know them as we continue here at the NAACP, our Youth Leadership Institute, and empowering our young people, that we make sure that they see you, and for those who want to be legislators there in the future, have an opportunity to meet you and learn more about what you do. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Last 30 seconds for our first show. Thank everyone for coming. Happy New Year. January 12th, we have Mandy Days Chapman, who is our chairperson for the Maternal and Infant Mortality Task Force. January 19th, we have the Attorney General, Gray Wolf of New Jersey. January 26th, the last program for the month, we have First Lady Tammy Murphy. Tune in every Tuesday when we fight, we win. When we fight, we win. Happy New Year.